Good evening. Thank you for coming. Tonight we're here to celebrate Dr. Suzanne Bergeron. This is a yay. This presentation is put on by Will Plus now, and we've had a series about feminism, and this one is about claiming your education. My name is Penny Kane. This is my fourth year in Will, and I have one more semester to go. I've had two directors, Dr. Francine Banner and Dr. Anna Mueller, and yet to come, Dr. Laura Roosh. So I'm excited about the next chapter, too. Dr. Bergeron has been here for decades. She's a professor of economics in women and gender studies and has developed many courses. She developed the two courses I had with her, which is Intro into Women and Gender Studies and Gender and Globalization. They're both fascinating. She's been a member of several boards and advisory committees. She's on the SOAR advisory board, which is very near and dear to my heart. She's a former director of Women and Gender Studies. She's been on the Women and Gender Studies Steering Committee and the Center for the Education of Women Scholarship Committee, also near and dear to my heart. She's one of the co-founders or founders of WILL, depending on who you're talking to. I think we'll get into a little discussion about that a little bit later. And I think most of the attendees here probably know her better than I do. I think there's some WILL alumni, some SOAR alumni, and many faculty members. Just like to give a little shout out to one of our WILL members tonight, Tamir Bell. He is a 2023 difference maker that was just announced today. And I'd like to have you all help me welcome Dr. Suzanne Bergeron for tonight's presentation. Thank you.
Where's my glasses? Oh, they are.
Well, thank you, Penny, and thank you, Will, for hosting me and for the faculty and students whose reflections inform this talk, and to Bruce for patiently listening to more stories from the past than anyone would care to hear. Look, here's another cool email from 1999. and of course, to all of you for coming. When Penny first approached me to talk to the WILL Plus students about the impact of feminism on higher education, we discussed a few options. Maybe the focus could be on successful faculty feminist challenges to discriminatory admissions, employment, and promotion practices. Or maybe how feminist student activism in the US made universities more receptive and relevant to women students' needs and lives. But as Penny and I talked about it further, we decided that I should talk about the ways that students and faculty have collaborated to create feminist change on this campus. What might especially resonate, we thought, were those efforts aimed at enhancing women students' abilities to do what feminist poet Adrienne Rich refers to as claiming an education. Claiming, rather than passively receiving, involves questioning received knowledge. It means identifying the perspectives and identities that are marginalized in the university and fighting for their inclusion. It means deep engagement, risk-taking, and believing in yourself. And for students to effectively claim their education also requires that faculty be ethically and intellectually committed to that project. While Rich was focused solely on the gender power dynamics that structure university learning, Audre Lorde's exhortation that there is no such thing as a single-issue struggle because we do not lead single-issue lives means we must also tackle exclusions based on race, sexuality, ability, class, gender identity, and more. Bell Hooks reminds us that addressing the material conditions of higher education involves fostering inclusive and engaging academic experiences while addressing the structural obstacles that all marginalized folks face in the university. And this, I contend, is precisely the work that the students and faculty in Women's and Gender Studies, WILL, and LGBTQ studies have been doing together. But there's little accounting of it. Much of that activity takes place outside of typical registers with their false distinctions between research, teaching, service, and activism. Faculty-student collaborations often unfold in casual spaces, a conversation in the student lounge, a chat in the hallway. And then there is a question of what is made visible and valuable in the university. Are collaborations that integrate feminist theory and practice held up, or are they dismissed as non-academic partisan efforts? I heard some amens out there. Consequently, many of the examples in this talk are drawn from non-official sources, informal email exchanges, interviews with faculty and students, and so forth. And from these sources, as well as more informal records, I have put together a few vignettes to show how feminist student and faculty collaborations have fostered students' enhanced ability to claim their educations. This is by no means comprehensive, rather a way to get the conversation going. And in the interest of time, I am not naming many of the players. The list of engaged students and faculty is long, but many of you are going to recognize yourselves in my stories. and some people who aren't here might recognize themselves in these stories too. And there will be plenty of time for sharing your own perspectives and reflections later tonight. So let me take a sip. And please feel free to get up and have things to drink and eat as I'm talking. This is casual. Vignette number one, the spark. I start with an account of the Intro to Women's Studies class I team taught with Marilee Benor in 1988 and its rippling impact. It was in this class that I first realized the power of women's and gender studies classes to get students to rethink their place in the world and the university. This is also a story about the spark of student activism that eventually ignited the Women in Learning and Leadership program. I'm not sure what drew those students who signed up for that class. I can't say they would have described themselves as feminists, although enrolling suggests something was simmering. They largely viewed their education as a means to an end: complete the class, finish a degree, get a job. However, as they explored the topics in the class, they came to see the effects of structural power and inequality in the world, and they started to change. They wanted to learn more and apply that knowledge to create a more just world. And over the years, I came to realize that this effect of sparking students' desires to claim their educations is common in women's and gender studies classes. As a recent program alum put it so well, I entered UM-Dearborn thinking I was going to get my degree and make myself as invisible as possible. But as I took these classes, I found myself believing I could make a difference, rejecting the message I had internalized as a disabled woman of color that I could not do much. But back to that first class. Many of these students were communications majors, excited about further developing their critical analysis and producing their own feminist media. So when Marilee passed around her undergraduate feminist newsletter, complete with her own poetry, those students were inspired to produce their own feminist newsletter, although strangely not their own poetry. I'm not sure why. They eventually formed an official student group called the Women's Studies Student Alliance, and the Alliance organized critical media workshops for the campus and local high schools, a Vagina Monologues performance and fundraiser, and served as mentors for the Women on the Move event, which invited socioeconomically disadvantaged women from Metro Detroit to consider college as an option. They also began to ask for additional classes, such as gender and media that Rashmi Luther developed, and women in politics to fill a gap in the political science curriculum at that time. And by the way, when students asked the existing political science professors why that gap existed, one noted, quote, "Women aren't interested in politics, so there is nothing to teach," unquote. While another stated that adding a module on women wasn't possible, as it would mean taking something important off the syllabus. So this seems like a good place to reflect on the institutional climate in which we were working back then. Oh good, this is working just as I planned. Our country was in the middle of a backlash against earlier progress made by feminist and anti-racist justice movements, to which our campus was not immune. There was only a handful of women's and gender studies in AAAS classes, and there was no major in either of these programs. Women's and gender studies curriculum was treated with disdain by many. I discovered this on my first day on the job. I had been on campus for maybe 5 minutes, visiting with Mayor Lee, when a colleague of hers, hearing I was teaching the Intro to Women's and Gender Studies course, quipped, "So will you be shrink-wrapping the speculum with the textbook?" Yeah, I think he said mirror and speculum. Enlightened. The almost daily microaggressions followed. Feminist scholarship and teaching was often viewed as illegitimate, and feminists themselves often belittled and excluded. Oh, there were a few feminists around, a small but active group. Sometimes we even ran into each other in the hallway. Such events were referred to as cabals by our male colleagues. We should have left our brooms at home. The climate for students was also not ideal in lots of ways. There was an active gay, straight alliance and black student union, but not much of a presence of women's rights students groups. Egregious faculty behavior was typically laughed off or justified. For instance, one colleague refused to write women recommendations for grad school as they were just going to get married, so why should he waste his time? Oh yes, all of this is true. When a student complained, the chair of his department defended this stance as the professor's prerogative. Another faculty member announced that he would give an A to any girl who wore a low-cut top and sat in the front row. When a colleague overheard this and complained to the chair, the response was that it sure sounded like affirmative action for women to him. After all, they were going to get A's. What's the problem? At that time, some people in this room remember that too. At that time, there was no recourse if a student was sexually harassed, no dedicated support on campus for those who experienced other forms of sexual violence, SOAR was not in existence, there was no Women's Resource Center, no gender-neutral bathrooms. I could go on, but we'd be here for a while. Okay, one more story, and then I'll move on to the next vignette. Because of its heavy involvement with women on the move, in 2002, the Alliance created a mentoring program for non-traditional students for the Castle College Option Program, which now goes by the name of SOAR. However, the mentoring program did not go as planned. It was initially envisioned as a unidirectional transfer of knowledge and skills from traditional to non-traditional students. Instead, it became a community of mutual support, co-learning, and co-mentoring. Many of the college option students had experience in and deep knowledge about community activism, working on issues like water and housing justice, violence prevention, support for returning citizens, and the like. The Alliance students quickly realized they had a lot to learn from those folks. They began to interrogate the savior-victim binary that originally informed their volunteer work, applying critical reflection they learned in the Women's and Gender Studies classroom to their practice. A number of students were in Maureen Linker's feminist philosophy class in that semester, and I think we're working out some of their ideas in the context of what you're teaching them. A couple of years later, these students helped us to keep college options from being shuttered because they believed that fostering non-traditional student success was a key equity issue. Anyway, with all this going on, the students began to wonder how they could build on what they were learning and doing on campus in Metro Detroit and beyond. One day, a student mentioned a program she heard of at the University of Richmond called the Women in Learning and Leadership Program. And maybe, she said, we could use that as a model for what we want to build at UM-Dearborn. And that brings me to vignette number two. So vignette number two is, will students claim their education and help other students claim theirs? Hi, founding member of Will, Christina. nice to see you. Putting our own spin on the Richmond model, in 2003, we started a Women in Learning and Leadership program now called Will Plus to help students connect what they learned in the classroom to activist and social change projects. It was explicitly designed as a socioeconomically and racially diverse co-generational learning community. The faculty developed a curriculum that aimed to inspire students to claim their feminist educations. The co-curricular activities were determined by the students themselves. The founding group of WILL members very much set the tone with their focus on addressing gender-based violence. And this has been an enduring theme in WILL and an important example of students claiming their own education. So by applying and deepening the knowledge they gain in the classroom to social change and engage in praxis, as well as an example of helping all UMD students claim their educations through prevention and support for survivors. The founding group was also interested in empowering middle school girls in Metro Detroit, which became a reality in the Phoenix After School Program for Latinas in Southwest Detroit, where WILL students, supported by many faculty partners, especially Marilee Benoit, developed their own classes on writing, and we have one of the writing instructor is here tonight, Amy, to develop the writing class, photo voice, media literacy, body image, health and wellness, career workshops, encouraging girls in STEM, and a campus visit complete with a cool lab experiment workshop. Wilsters working at Phoenix came to us and told us they needed a better understanding of Latina youth than we offered in our own curriculum, which we still offer none, and that's shameful. And so we filled that gap with an outside expert. And I mean, I'm just talk about students claiming their educations by saying, we see a gap in our curriculum, and we want to fill it, right? This program created real change for the girls who participated. It ran for about 5 years. It inspired so many of our students' career paths. And one of the students who was a participant is now a celebrated community leader in Southwest Detroit, who to this day credits the program for changing her life. The founding WILL members also wanted to support incarcerated women. And in this, they were very much inspired by the classes offered by Laura Lempert, as well as her activism around clemency for women who were incarcerated for defending themselves against violent abusers. They served as teaching assistants in the prison. They eventually got involved in the Inside Out prison education, too, and our current WILL director, Anya Mueller, teaches in that program. So we see a continuity here. People can clap for Anya. I like that. But let me return to projects addressing gender-based violence, a continued yet evolving focus of our work. Before the Women's Resource Center was created, women's and gender studies faculty, many of whom are like widely internationally recognized experts on gender-based violence. I mean, we have really deep bench strength in this and have for 30, 40 years. We were the key campus resource for student survivors. So if someone experienced violence, there was no one else they could go to, and they'd come to our offices. And I remember Pam McCausland writing up a little pamphlet, and we all had it on our desks so we knew who to call and the right things to say, because there was nothing else on campus. We knew this was not ideal, and we have been consistent in our request for effective prevention training and policies, and for compassionate and robust dedicated student services to promote healing and thriving for survivors always. Early WILL work on this issue emphasized the need for such support and education to challenge myths about sexual assault. And a lot of this was done through WILL's involvement in Take Back the Night. Now, WILL didn't start this event on campus, but by the second year, they took it over. And here's why. The first one we had on campus included a training by a so-called self-defense expert who claimed that her classes could protect you from strangers sneaking up on you, asserting that if all women got the self-defense training, gender-based violence would be a thing of the past. Now, there is so much wrong with what I just said. I would be here all night unpacking all the wrong. Well, one of our WILL students was there and spoke out against this at the event, particularly the way stranger assaults were presented in by this so-called expert as the most prevalent, leaving out the vast majority of incidents of gender-based violence in which the victim knows the perpetrator. And after that misstep, the WILL student said, we're going to take this over so the campus can get it right. And we, the faculty, backed them up, and they've had a huge role in the annual Take Back the Night ever since. See, I bet you didn't know all these cool stories. The things in my emails. Institutional memory. We should just like download the whole thing, put it in your office, Marty, you know, for future generations. Scary thought. And if the first phase of WILL work on violence was about awareness and challenging myths, The second phase involved building coalitions inside and outside of the university, deepening relationships with local service, social service agencies, building a bridge to the Metro Detroit activist arts community, working with Arab Student Union to challenge the gender politics of Islamophobia post 9/11, and other kinds of coalitions. They actually worked with fraternities in a white ribbon campaign to get men involved in the fight against gender-based violence. And the next phase of work took a more intersectional approach to addressing violence that centered on the experiences of minoritized survivors. The final phase of the Will Anti-Violence work I'll talk about tonight gave more focus to policy issues. 10 years or so ago, universities, including our own, grappled with mounting evidence regarding gender-based violence and its impact on college students, while at the same time navigating changing regulations around Title IX to manage misconduct. Will students experience the failures of our new Title IX systems? One of them was sexually harassed in her on-campus job, and when she went to the Title IX office to report, was told that they could help her find another job on campus. She, being a Will student, said, "I'm the victim here. I am not changing my work or my life because of this harasser." The Title IX officer, yes. The Title IX officer did not change their approach, and the student ended up transferring out. Well, this really raised our antennae, right? And galvanized Will students and allied groups to push for better policies on campus. At students' request, the faculty organized an event on effective, evidence-based approaches to training and prevention for the senior officers and others, and this was meant to promote an alternative to the minimal compliance online training strategy that UM-Dearborn did choose to pursue. Hopefully not forever. In 2017, Will students with faculty input were the ones who wrote the syllabus edition alerting students to their right to safety. So the thing you have on your, that was written by Will students. Yeah. And I mean, they asked the faculty for their input, but we were like, oh, put a comma here, you know? It was pretty good. Soon after, Lisa Martin and Francine Banner organized a full-day conference on negotiating boundaries in the Me Too era. And this in turn sparked more Will policy. And Will, in the past 5 years, because of this focus on policy, they brought in Senator Stabenow, Representative Dingell, Michigan Governor Whitmer, and Attorney General Nestle to campus as part of Take Back the Night. Yep, pretty impressive. Okay, one final thing I'll say about Will. There's a million things I could say about Will, but this is like vignettes, right? So I'm just sparking you for your own stories. And is how much Will has helped students claim their education because of the support they provide each other and the sense of inclusion that brings for students who wouldn't otherwise feel at home on campus. As one student wrote me a few years ago, Will is an excellent program for a commuter school like ours because of the camaraderie with the other women when we get together to brainstorm common women's issues as well as class and university issues. As another wrote to me recently, quote, "I was a first generation student. I wouldn't have graduated without the support of Women's and Gender Studies and Will." So let me turn to the third vignette, and I'll keep it short. And this is about the LGBTQ task force. Now, this task force, this initiative was sparked in 2009 when my Intro to Women's and Gender Studies class became intensely focused on LGBTQ issues on campus. In that class, a number of students shared their experiences of homophobia and transphobia, along with their concern that the university was not responding well. While Flint, Eastern, Ann Arbor, and Oakland had LGBTQ centers and courses, we had close to nothing. Sure, we had the rainbow flag on the inclusion webpage and a couple of speakers a year, but no center, no designated leadership, no space, no accessible resources, no training, no curriculum, no gender-neutral bathrooms, etc. Queer students seeking support in the counseling center found the therapists had little knowledge about LGBTQ mental health issues. Campus safety brushed off transphobic violence that occurred in restrooms as a misunderstanding. There were repeated homophobic slurs and threats made against LGBTQ students in one student lounge, and this was a couple of years after that, and that wasn't adequately addressed. And I remember getting those complaints, and Marty, it was one of your first weeks on the job. And I was coming from a night class, and at 9 o'clock at night, and Marty was the new dean, and I told him what was going on in that lounge, and we stood in that hallway with tears in our eyes. And we said, we have to do something about this. I mean, it was really a problem on campus. And so conversations happened at provost level, and we started this LGBTQ task force, a student-faculty-staff partnership dedicated to finding more about the campus climate and services or lack thereof and making recommendations. And Shane, you were on that task force, weren't you? Oh, yeah, we had really great people on that. While not all of our recommendations were taken, we did get an LGBTQ coordinator at first quarter time. I think they were offering to pay $10 an hour. So we couldn't keep anyone. At first quarter time, then half time, now full time, who could provide training, resources, referral support, and guidance to the campus, including training for campus police and the counseling center. We pushed for dedicated space where LGBTQ students could feel safe and welcome, and for a while anyway, we had that. And last but certainly not least, the task force recommendation that we hire an LGBTQ scholar to offer courses that our queer students were demanding led to Amy Brainerd's hire and the eventual creation of the LGBTQ certificate program. I am smiling so hard. I can't help it. That program offers a wide range of courses and a diverse faculty teaching about various aspects of LGBTQ life so that people have the knowledge to care effectively about and for their community. Again, think about it. This program emerged from students actively claiming their educations by challenging a curriculum that otherwise ignored, distorted, and devalued their lives and experiences. These are students claiming an education. And as we find out more about student needs, the curriculum has grown, for instance, adding new courses in sexuality and disability studies. We're also finding out more about the evolving needs of LGBTQ students, what services and material supports might facilitate their ability to keep claiming their educations. So I'm going to end my examples here, not my talk, even though there is so much more to share with you. The ongoing efforts by LGBTQ students and faculty to obtain appropriate and consistent support, the ways that WGST faculty and students came together to advocate for appropriate lactation spaces on campus, joint efforts around reproductive health and justice, student faculty efforts to address food insecurity, and more. Further, such work does not only occur in women's and gender studies. A similar set of stories could in fact be told about the engagement between African and African American studies faculty and students, particularly the Black Student Union, which played such a crucial role in advocating for that program to launch a major. So we could do a download of Deborah Smith Pollard's emails too. But she's like, no, you won't. I think that most of us agree that many of these developments have been positive. But the work is far from done, and institutional narratives of progress should be approached with caution. In the US today, we are currently seeing an attack on curriculum that draws on critical gender, sexuality, and race theories, and our campus is not immune. Our programs require defending and institutional support. Further, progress narratives can sometimes reinforce inequalities. A celebration of the rise in the number of women who attend and finish college glosses over the inequalities that determine which race, class, gendered people get into college in the first place, what resources they get, and who finishes. Policies on trans inclusion can gloss over devastating forms of transphobic backlash. Women's and gender studies is closer to the threshold of academic legitimacy than when I was hired. And some of our methods have been taken up widely. For instance, the feminist concept of praxis as a unity of theory and practice most certainly informs our current project and practice-based learning initiatives, even if this isn't always made explicit. You know, they don't always point back and say this came from feminism, even though it did. but this often means that we lose sight of the dismissal, rejection, and hostility that feminist work, along with the work of African and African American studies, continues to face. Some feminisms get taken up easily in spaces of higher ed. What others, those not easily incorporated into celebrations of middle-class white women's successes, can get left behind. Speaking out about ongoing and evolving inequalities and reasserting the importance of feminist education when celebratory progress narratives take a hold can lead to the dismissal of those who offer crucial feminist insights as stuck behind the new times as ungrateful killjoys. And this, I contend, is a big institutional loss. Further, the conditions under which students can actively claim their feminist educations are deteriorating today due to many forces. Declining state funding for higher education narrows access and often saddles students with crippling levels of debt. The vocationalization of higher ed, preparing people cheaply and quickly to meet corporate labor demands, can make programs like ours seem irrelevant. Further, as a women's and gender studies faculty and student team, Liz Rohan, who's here tonight, and Dale Held, they wrote in the Michigan Daily last week, a system of inequitable funding in the University of Michigan system has contributed to a decline in funding for the liberal arts, including women's and gender studies at Dearborn. Campus policies meant to protect students from sexual harassment and violence on campus are weak and re-victimize survivors. And a recent national studies shows that many who reported violence on campus have experienced adverse effects to their safety and privacy because of it. Reduced access to reproductive care is certainly going to derail the educational desires of many. And in 25 years, when I return to campus, to hear then-Chancellor Lisa Martin give a talk like this prior to her own retirement, these will be the issues she'll likely refer to as the ones that this feminist community has grappled with. So one more thought, then I'll close. I bet you're wondering what happened to those students who claimed those feminist educations going back 25 years. What path did they follow? Well, for one of them, working with the women at the correctional facility changed her life, and she is now a leader in a nonprofit that works to improve the lives of at-risk girls and women. I thought I wouldn't cry, but maybe I was wrong. Another is an educator and a state representative, only our second state representative that's come out of Will. Only our second. And her participation in the Phoenix program helped her to see how education could lead to empowerment for girls and women, and it's what set her on her own life path. Another switched her major from engineering after being inspired by her women's and gender studies classes, and now leads diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives for the city of Toledo. Another works for Oxfam, lobbying the World Bank to focus on gender equity in policy making. Many are therapists and social workers, improving the lives of those from marginal communities. Becky, who is a Will and SOAR student, is now working in the SOAR program, building the next generation of leaders. Two of the students who launched the LGBTQ task force are now the publishers of Between the Lines, the premier LGBTQ newspaper in Michigan. Isn't that wild? I'll leave it at that. One of the original alliance members is a midwife. Another is an environmentalist, while another teaches English, including feminist literature, at a local high school. Will has been a particularly successful incubator for leadership development. As one student says, Will made me realize that one person can make a difference and that activism is both addictive and contagious. Another says, Will helped her see the connection between acting for social justice, which is the cause, and leadership, which is the effect. Another put it this way, quote, I have become a community leader. My work and life are never complete at the end of the day, and I am always searching for new issues to address. I never could have said that before Will. Another wrote, quote, I've realized that theory and practice do not exist separately in an authentic life. Combined, they lead to effective actions that can have a real and lasting impact. Should we be surprised by any of this? Not at all. For as Adrienne Rich pointed out, once we claim our educations and begin to feel committed to our lives and responsible to ourselves, we can never again be satisfied with the old passive way. And I know people in this room will never again be satisfied. the end. So I hope that was fun. A little historical, a little in the weeds for people who like been on campus for a minute. But so are there any questions, comments, stories to share?
I feel like I got the classroom experience. I had you both online, both the classes I had with you were online. And now I get the in-person Dr. Bergeron, so that was good.
It's kind of the Dr. Bergeron classroom experience, except it would look kind of more like this. And there would be chalk flying everywhere, but yeah. But I was told to stay in front of the mic. So
I was 38 years old, returning to college, and I was taking women in politics, and she was discussing about women being out in the world, and I was like, well, what do you mean? Don't women want to stay home and have children and do all those things? I just watched her puff like a pufferfish. And a couple days later, she's like, I have something for you. You need to come join Will. And it was the second year, and it changed my life. And forever grateful. Thank you.
So great to see you, Amy. Not known people in this group, be quiet.
No, I'm one of the original members of Will, and it totally changed my life. But there was a lot of us in the first class of Intro to Women's Studies, and when you were talking and just laying out the basics, we were like, oh my God. It just changed our lives completely.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell them about Luce?
About what?
Luce, about the student who is on our program.
Oh, Luce, there was a young lady who moved here from California, and it was her first year at this inner city school, and she went to the program. And years later, I caught up with her, and she was like, oh my God, you're Christina, my mentor. And I had totally forgotten about her because I used to concentrate on the girls that were ill-behaved. They got more of my attention. And then she said it was the first time she had ever been introduced to like college anything. And then when she finished the program, she was like, I am going to go to U of M. She went to U of M Ann Arbor. She went into economy. As an economist, she got her master's. She is now working with a higher ed program created by a lady from DT, but she was working with the county. And she credits the Phoenix program for like changing her life completely. We have several, I keep in touch with several of the young girls that we've mentored, and it was, they felt heard, and they just loved it. We loved it. We all grew through the program.
I think that was in big part due to somebody with a big heart who took care of them. One year, there was a stowaway on the bus. Do you remember that? One of the girls snuck onto the bus and came to campus when they weren't supposed to. And so then there was a little bit of, oh God, what do we do now? But it was all fine.
Yes. No, and we, and a big component of the Will, of the Phoenix program, we made them do civic engagement. Like we did a cleanup or we did something in the community, and everybody participated, and it changed the lives of the leaders, the people who taught, the creative writing. Laura Freeman did a whole photography thing. Everybody, I don't know how many Will students were involved in each year, but I mean, we put a comprehensive program together of like 3 months of every Friday, with snacks, with curriculum, but it wouldn't have been anything without the support of all of our teachers.
Professors. Like that thing, like the writing professors would help, would assist Amy in creating these writing workshops, and then the science professor would help develop the lab, and so forth. And one of the anthropologists helped develop like a nutrition program.
Well, talk about the photo voice, because that was what Laura did with the girls.
Well, you're the one who got the photo voice training, but yeah, one of the things we did is we sent the young girls out with cameras to just take pictures of their communities, and then they wrote their own stories about it, and then we actually put on what was like an art gallery type show on campus, and then invited them all to see what they had done. And that was cool. But we had incredible students who were doing
that. There are people that spend their entire lives being photographers. And they go to the best art schools, and they go to the best MFA programs, and some of the photos that those young women took were on par with anything you would see.
Flaming hot Cheetos.
That's what this camera is about. It's from Arts and Agency. We're taking pictures of what makes us happy this week.
And they were disposable cameras. That was back in that time. It was an amazing program.
Yes.
So today, I've been in training for a new job all of this week. It'll be 2 week training with a nonprofit organization by the name of Nation Outside. And today we had an hour long conversation about intersectionality. Mm-hmm. And I had my laptop with me, and I'm like, you all wouldn't believe I just turned in an essay about this. I had it at 11:59. And I said, I had never heard of this term before. I said, but it was part of my women in gender studies class. I kind of went on a little bit about how great a professor you were.
Thank you.
And, so I joined Will Plus and taking women in gender studies at the same time. So I had a lot of new, fresh information and education, and they were slightly teaching about intersectionality, slightly off, and I started talking about it, and my new boss was like, well, why don't you come up in front and just teach us about everything you learn, right?
That is awesome.
So I actually did that for about 30 minutes today, and it's all credit to the learning that I got for Women in Gender Studies and Will Plus, and it's just been a real life-changing thing for me. And the last thing I will say is that after our first Will Plus event, we got these pins, and they were pins that say things like feminism, and they had like a picture of a person with a blindfold on, and I had about 3 pins, and I actually wore it on this sports jacket, and one of my her youngest sister, one of the twins, said, hey, what does that word mean? It was feminism. And I explained it to her, and she was like, guys care about stuff like that? And I'm like, what does God do?
Other remembrances? Yeah, Mary Lee, you got something else?
Because I'm a few years older than most of you. And mm-hmm. when I came here, for a couple summers, I offered a camp for Girl Scouts with some other female faculty members, which was so much fun for me until my colleagues told me, because I was on tenure, we really love what you do. We're going to miss you when you're gone, because that's not the kind of work you can do to become tenured here. So I put it on the back burner, and then Suzanne came. And somehow I think I had convinced somebody to let me teach women in gender studies. I was supposed to teach it with Laura Lempert. Is she here? I was terrified all summer. Just so worried about it. And then Suzanne came, and I'm like, oh yeah. So it was such an amazing experience, because that allowed me to leave. I'm still a scientist, but it allowed me to explore the important other aspects of what we need to bring, you know, as Marty, I was just reading there, the humanities into science, because science isn't going to survive unless we blend it more and better. So if it weren't for Suzanne, you'd see a lot less of me, so I know that would be so hard for you. So. And then Suzanne can tell you about the time we took a bunch of students down to Cincinnati. Okay, we won't talk about that.
Well, they learned so much at the conference, but then we were like trying to find stragglers on the bridge from Cincinnati to Kentucky at 3 o'clock in the morning. So we only took older students after that. We took you to San Francisco. Yes.
And we presented on the Phoenix program, didn't we?
Yeah. Not only did we take Will to San Francisco and they presented the Phoenix project program, did the people in the audience, there were about 40 other women's and gender studies faculty in the audience, and they said, this should have been the keynote of the conference. They thought you students were outstanding. They were blown away. Were there, other things to add about the bad old days, about the good times, about the, yes, Rashmi?
Well, she got up. I could have done it sitting down.
Yeah.
I just want to get up to say, you know, some of my best co-travelers and buddies on campus over so many years. That's why I want to get up. I know it's more personal, right? Will, and I don't want to interrupt what the students have been saying, but to have that kind of journey together on a campus just means everything. And, you know, it's like, I think of the time that Will was an idea. You know, the two of us sitting there, right? I was more involved in the WGST side. You know, we created, like, when we conceptualized the major. We're doing this, but at the same time, Will is an idea. I just think of us sitting there and thinking, what would this look like? How would this be? Suzanne is asking, what do you, like, she's showing me these models from different places, right? And we're thinking, what would this actually be like on our campus? I can't imagine, like, you know, that those chats we had, when something like that, that's just an incipient idea, and then look at what happened. It's hard to imagine, it's hard to believe. And your insistence, I just wanted to say this, because I remember, it was just so amusing to think of it now. The early days of Will, right? What was one of the struggles? And Suzanne sitting down and saying, you know, I could sort of, like it, when students are struggling to think about what is like their priority in a particular year, what program do we want to give energy and time to, and they're struggling making these decisions, I could just make the decision, right? Remember that? Remember that? And she's like, I know, but you know, that's going to defeat like the whole purpose of Will. So I'm going to just sit back and I'm going to watch the struggle, even though it's painful, because you want to go in and say, hey, this is the solution. This is what you probably should be prioritizing. But no. And that's hard for people like us. I mean, Suzanne, she knows. You know, for us to sort of sit back and, you know, not sort of take the reins or not say, hey, you know, this, like, maybe we could do this. But you just, you know, like, it's that, you kept that, the prize right in front of you.
And then the people who followed, I mean, that's the thing, is that we had all these great directors that followed. So we kept the momentum going.
It was definitely a team effort with all the professors.
Yep. That's why this talk's like this. This is not a, you know, this is not a, I'm leaving, here's all the heroic things I did. You know, it's a, this never would have happened if it wasn't a team. If it wasn't all of us working together, students, faculty, staff, having a vision, carrying it out together. And that's what matters. Oh, yeah. Well, so one of the founding Will students, all she wanted to do was study science, and her husband didn't want her to go to school. He didn't want her to study science. And as we know, for a lot of returning women students, their families can sabotage them. Mm-hmm. This is something Ellen and I talked about it when you first came here. And so he would, now you have to fold the laundry. You know, and she couldn't study for exams, so she would come in and drop out. She wanted to fly here today, but she couldn't because she's finishing up her rotations in her, she's a resident, and she's going to be an MD in a couple of months. And she's like 55 years old, but she had a dream. We supported her. She eventually realized, well, this marriage was like not for her, not supporting her dreams. And all she ever wanted to do was do science and medicine. And she's done it.
But Intro to Women's Studies. Totally.
Oh, yeah. She came in being like a Rush Limbaugh lover. But we turned that ship around. Not that there's anything wrong with Rush Limbaugh, of course, you know.
Not forget this, or the honey bun. Oh, yeah. The name you gave my husband.
Yes.
tried to sabotage.
Right.
Me,
and when we just said, no, this is the things you have to look out for. This is, and so we'll do some workarounds, you know, and this is how you can manage it. And we read a lot of articles. These are outside of our research areas, but to figure out how we could help make sure that these returning students could stay in school and finish. But, you know, that was all of us, and a lot of our psych faculty helped with that. Other kinds of ongoing struggles, memories, stories? Because there's lots of generations from Will here, not just the founders. And
I don't have a struggle to share, but just I guess an observation. So Will was already well established when I came to campus in 2008, or fairly well established. And that second floor hallway was just a powerhouse of my colleagues in women and gender studies, African American studies. And so there's always been this close relationship between SOAR and Will. And some of the best SOAR students, and some of them are here tonight, participated in Will and also participated in SOAR. And I look back and I see, and this is true, and Anya can say too, this is still true today, that when there's that combination of someone coming into SOAR and also participating in Will, those tend to be some of our most sort of successful on their own terms and with their, you know, individuals, and also really strong mentors who give back to the community. So I loved those early days. Just for me, you know, I was a non-traditional student. I graduated from here, but I didn't have any of the kinds of experiences that we're talking about. And then when I came to campus, I was just wrapped. It's like I found my people, you know. Like, I've been looking for my people, and I found my people, you know. And then the students, just to watch them flourish over the years, it's just been amazing. It's been amazing.
Yeah. Thanks for the nomination, by the way. You had to be nominated. You used to have to be nominated into
If I may, so I mentioned that moment when the SOAR program was almost shuttered. So they were going to shut the SOAR program down, and they said it didn't belong in Castle. And so then the students were very upset because they'd been mentoring, and I was, of course, upset, and others of us. And so one of the things we did is we did this very super unscientific. We looked at all the SOAR students, and we looked at grade point averages and who stayed. Retention, and then we tracked that against who took women's and gender studies class and who took African-American studies class. And what we found was the students who were able to connect with their own lives, their own experiences here, their own voices in the university were more likely to then really own their educations and feel like they belonged here. And so it was, I wish we could do that again. We didn't really have the numbers. When I put it together, it was close enough for folk music, and the dean was an anthropologist, so, like, no offense, Rose, but it was like, you know, it was a little ethnographic research of 12 people, and she was, and we sold it. And we sold it, and that's how we kept it here. And it was not my idea. The students said to me, well, we noticed something. The SOAR students who stay are the ones we see in our women's and gender studies and African-American studies classes. So they had the idea for the argument, and I was like, Eureka! You know, this is the argument for it belongs in Castle. It's got a curricular component. Anyway, so that was kind of wild. And the late Susan Kushner was super instrumental here. So it was me and Kushner, a few other women's and gender studies people, and then these students like, how are we gonna save SOAR? That was awesome.
What year was that SOAR almost closed down?
I think it was like 2003, 2004. And yeah, and then we were able to hire Ellen a couple years later, so 2008, yeah. So that was great. Yes. Allison.
First of all, thank you to all of the staff here, especially you, Dr. Bergeron. Like, I learned so much from so many faculty members that were here, and made some different kinds of moves in my time since graduating, but like have been able to carry on like all of the education that I've gotten from you guys even well past that. So just so thankful to all of you. It was well worth the $36,000 in debt. But I wanted to share one of my more fond memories, and it kind of started off as kind of a painful memory, but being a Will member, I obviously attended several Take Back the Night events, and they were always amped up, and they always kind of held some sort of controversy, you know, and that was just to be kind of expected. But my graduating year, so 2016, we had our mattress stolen.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had our mattress stolen, and there was all of our signage was graffitied, and it was a really painful kind of experience for a lot of us. I think you know where I'm going with this. But someone had graffitied on it, leftist cooks.
Be a bunch of leftist cooks.
Leftist crooks. And so we, in response, not only got even louder than I had ever imagined at the march that night, but Heather, one of the other Will members, had created a bunch of pins that said leftist cooks.
I still have that pin, and I wore it to the recognition lunch. That was the best.
Yes. So I would like to say that in looking around the room, I have a really good shot at Dr. Pollard. I have a really good shot of other people in the room. You, Dr. Schaub, people I did not actually have classes with. Dr. Jarinski, I did have a class with you, but I never had a class with you, Maureen. I see Lydia in the back. I'm sitting next to Melissa. I went to lunch with Ben yesterday in Ann Arbor. I just think I'm gonna cry. I got such a gift from this place, and I got so much out of this experience. Dr. Luthra, Dr. Rohan, I think about how every time I was just with these incredible artists in Kalamazoo who gave an unbelievable talk, and we were talking about novels. And I said, we were starting to talk about Octavia Butler, but I asked if anyone had ever read Gloria Naylor's Linden Hills. Mm-hmm. And I have recommended that book over and over and over again and said, you have to see the inferno through this black lens. You have to see this incredible work. And then I got to say that The Secret History by Donna Tartt is the whitest white thing that I've ever read. And then the curator with whom I work wrote that down, which is awesome. And The Secret History is still a terrible, terrible book that no one should ever, ever read. But
Shane has no opinions.
Every time I think about this space and these people, I think about the literal intersections that you made in my life. And I will be forever grateful.
Thank you, Shane. But I want to say, Shane was the glue that held us together for so, well, I hate to say how many years you were here. Maybe you don't want to. I mean, these waves of Will students would come through, and then Shane was just so there for all of them. So you gave back probably more than we gave to you, really. You're just the heart and soul of, you know, that program for so long. So really appreciate it. And all the pictures, we have a trove of amazing pictures that Shane took of a lot of our events. So that was great. Yes. Merrily, you're hogging this.
But we were at Phoenix one day, and we were doing something, and you have such a poker face, which is probably great for politics, I'm guessing, right? And these girls were making some things that were awful. And you were sitting there going, it's so nice. So you went, you know, you're in the right field because you could just keep that facade up while you just listen.
Yep.
It's so funny. Oh my
God. I'm going to stand too. Sorry if my back is to you guys. But I project. I want everyone in this room, whether I had a class with you, whether you've never seen my face before, or you're like, I think I know you, to not take the term of life-changing as like a cliche thing. Mm. Because all of us have been part of, like, let's talk about the intersectionality and the ripple effect. And I talk about it a lot with my kids. This literally changed my life. I would not know her. I would not know the majority of these people had Dr. Bergeron not come up to me in gender and globalization and said, hey, I think you should join this group. And I was like, all right, sure, why not? That sounds like fun. And again, literally change the path and change how I do things, how I live my life, how I help out. For some reason, I got put in the path of a lot of young people and help mold and change their life. To help become part of their village because of the village we had here. Mm. it's a pretty powerful thing. And if we take anything away, don't take any of that kind of power that we've gotten lightly. And just remember we have that power still, even on days where we don't feel like we do. Mm. So thank you for sharing your energy and your powers with me.
How many Will students have passed through at Vista Maria?
Yes. I was in charge of our internship program for a while. U of M Dearborn students got first dibs. But they're like, I'm a member of Will. I was like, you're in. I don't know where I'm putting you. But I got you. I got you. Right? Like, I got you. You're there. But no, we've had a number of Willsters come in. We have a couple who are still with us. It was a pretty powerful connection and continues to be.
Thank you for mentoring so many of our students.
Yeah. I don't know if what you do is called mentoring. we're all driving the bus together. I just keep us on the road.
Yes.
Is there an alumni group of the Will people? How is it to keep the momentum going or to grow it?
Well, on Facebook, kind of. We had a reunion 10 years ago, and then now it's our 20th. So I guess we're going to have to work with, the alumni people to get a more complete list of email addresses, and we'll probably have an event. I mean, there's talk. What are you thinking, Anya? Well, you're stepping in.
Laura, yeah, but we are actually meeting in a week or two with the current Well members to start talking about this.
Yeah. But we should get a photo tonight.
Is there a sign-in sheet?
No, there's not.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, all of these people, Paul, I invited all of these, the alumni, because I just went through my list of Facebook friends and said, oh, that was a Will student, that was a Will student. And then I sent them individual, it's not ideal. Oh, yeah.
And I never heard of a group. The engineering group and all the business group and all these activities that take place. And I think that this is an area where the group could start to get some more traction.
It's a good idea.
To the alumni and bring other alumni into this. Because my wife, taught here for so many years, but these stories were marvelous to hear.
Oh, good. I'm glad to hear
it. The university, it should be shared more throughout the alumni as a whole, not just amongst yourselves.
That's a really good point. I mean, we used to get the word out a little bit more, but we also used to be in the spotlight a little bit more, but I feel like the spotlight is shifted away from Castle in some ways. I think I'll just put it that way. Maybe we need to shift it back. Yeah. Other questions, comments, stories? Yes.
What are you doing with your retirement?
Yeah. Well, I don't know. So I've never had a plan. Yeah. I'm not really a person who has a plan. And so wherever the road takes me. But Bruce and I we've retired to Cape Cod, Massachusetts. And so I grew up in Massachusetts, and I worked on Cape Cod as a teenager. And in fact, that's where I became a feminist, really, working at a Girl Scout camp. That's something Mary Lee and I have in common. The Girl Scouts made us feminists. That sounds like a title of a bad book. So I'll continue to do some research and writing, and then I'll just see where it goes from there. Bruce and I are both very interested in adult education, and maybe finding a way to work more closely with adult learners, because we were always really committed to the non-traditional students here. Or maybe I'll just perfect my semolina bread recipe, because Dr. Martin sent me the Zingerman's recipe I have it on my phone, so.
Dr. Martin, please share.
And I'll send it to you. I'll look you up.
We do need a picture, and maybe a T-shirt for everybody.
Sure, but we don't have a T-shirt tonight.
It's only 7:15. Not that I want to make you talk, but I don't want to put the students involved in LGBTQ struggles on the spot or anything. But I think we've had some successes, but I think there's still a lot of work to be done there. So I guess that's something I would say. So are we?
I'll go.
Yeah, go ahead.
The phrase, the personal is political, was like the life-changing moment in your intro class. And that is what set me off into just taking women and gender studies as a double major and just understanding, like, the thing I could never really put into words was put into words. And I think it's just something I carry with me still to this day. And I don't know, it's just deeper than that. And just taking your globalization class, like the Bananas book, I forget what it's called.
Bananas, Beaches, and Bases,
yeah.
Making Feminist Sense of International Politics.
And the Tomatoes book, and yeah. We would just, yeah. It'd be like 6 p.m., 9 p.m., and we'd just be talking food and politics.
Yes.
And
yeah, we didn't want to leave. It was great.
We would each bring snacks every day.
Yeah, and we try to do the countries that we were studying. So the woman who wrote the Tomatoes book, Deborah Barnt, who studies like food systems and food justice globally, I was invited to teach a course at York University in Toronto, and Deborah Barnt had me over for dinner. And as you might imagine, it was fabulous. But that was because I taught the book, and she was so excited that, you know, so many generations of our students had read that book. So I was very lucky.
Life-changing. And the people in the classes, you know, you just carry on with your lives years later, and you're still in touch, and just deep.
Yeah, that's good to hear. Mm-hmm. Yes, Erin.
So I remember taking the Intro to Women's Studies class, and I think it was my second year of undergrad, and I had been kind of floating aimlessly, you know, just trying to find my place. And I remember in one of the early classes, we were talking about street harassment. And I think I sent this to you maybe in my email, I can't remember, but it's a story that I've always remembered. And I had been experiencing that, you know, throughout most of my life at that point, but I didn't know it had a name. And I definitely didn't know it had like research and a movement around it. So that really just was like a holy shit, what is this kind of moment? Like, this is awesome. And I remember at the time, someone mentioned it earlier, Will at that time, and it may have changed since then, but it had kind of like a secret society vibe to it. Like, you had to be nominated and then you interviewed,
yeah.
Right?
Yes. Yeah.
And I remember somebody in that class, I guess, liked something that I had to say, and somehow I was like nominated and I got told about Will and I was so excited. And I remember, you know, I applied, I was super into it. I think I interviewed with you, and I hadn't thought of this for years until I was hearing all these stories today. I remember I interviewed with you for Will. I was really excited about it. I came home and I called this guy I was dating at the time, and I called him on a landline. This is how long ago this was. It's been a minute. And I called him and I said, you know, I had the interview for Will today. And I remember he said, oh, did you blow it? And I said, no, actually it went really well. I think I'm gonna get in. So I dumped him, I got into Will. Isn't that funny? I haven't thought of that in years, but yes.
Good choice.
I know, right? Fork in the road moment.
Well, maybe people want to mingle and tell more stories among yourselves. And there's a sign-in sheet going around. I think there's a little bit more food. And
I think before we all disperse, can we get a picture of all the Will members?
Let's do it.
Okay. So thank you, everyone, for coming.